Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Sovereign of a Free People, Abraham Lincoln, Majority Rule, and Slavery by James H. Reed. Narrated by Joshua Saxon. 1. The Only True Sovereign of a Free People. A majority, held in restraint by constitutional checks and limitations, and always changing easily with deliberate changes of popular opinion and sentiments, is the only true sovereign of a free people. Abraham Lincoln, First Inaugural Address, March 4, 1861. Abraham Lincoln was elected president on November 6, 1860, but by the time he took his oath of office, 7 slave states had already seceded from the Union rather than accept the legitimacy of his election. If slaveholders' preferred candidate had won, those 7 states would have remained in the Union and demanded that the free states respect the election results. The principal cause of the American Civil War was slavery, which had been a festering, unresolved issue since the earliest years of the Republic. But the immediate trigger, the spark that ignited the long-accumulating fuel, was slaveholders' refusal to accept the results of a presidential election that did not go their way. Democracy means rule by the people. But the people never share identical interests and goals. Instead, as Abraham Lincoln observed in his first inaugural address, we divide into majorities and minorities with sometimes sharply conflicting views on matters of great importance. Majority vote is a decision rule intended to resolve such disagreements peacefully, but nothing guarantees that the majority's aims are wise or just. And sometimes opinions on important issues are so diverse and fragmented that no majority position exists at all. Deep and increasingly bitter conflicts plague many contemporary democracies, including the United States, where political polarization is greater now than at any time since the 1870s, when the wounds of the Civil War were still fresh. The institution of slavery no longer exists in the United States. But willingness to resort to extreme measures rather than accept adverse election results, which in 1860 was the flashpoint for secession and civil war, has returned as a significant factor in today's deeply polarized American politics. Today, the future of American democracy appears uncertain in the wake of a violent insurrection on January 6, 2021, fueled by a defeated incumbent president's false claims of a stolen election. That insurrection failed to halt the constitutionally prescribed counting of electoral votes in Congress, and in that respect, America's democratic institutions demonstrated their resilience. But the continued acceptance of the stolen election narrative by a significant minority of the U.S. population suggests that the degree of trust on which any system of democratic election depends has suffered significant erosion. Increasing numbers of Americans, especially on the political right, but evident at both ends of the political spectrum, regard the resort to political violence as legitimate. The post-election insurrection of 2021 differed in some obvious respects from the post-election pre-inauguration secessions of late 1860 and early 1861. The preemptive secessionists did not invent specious claims of a stolen election. Instead, they frankly acknowledged that Lincoln's position on slavery and the fact that he had been elected almost entirely by Northern voters motivated their act. Moreover, the secessionists were far more numerous, powerful, and consequential than the insurrectionists who assaulted the Capitol on January 6th. But the preemptive secessionists of 1860-61 and the insurrectionists of 2021 shared a fundamental unwillingness to accept the legitimacy of an election that turned out differently than they had hoped. Unless citizens with deeply opposed views can agree to play by a shared set of political rules, democracy becomes impossible and is replaced by warfare. This book examines Abraham Lincoln's thoughtful, hopeful statement of democracy's promise, that popular self-government, through the procedure of constitutional majority rule, is capable of peacefully addressing not merely routine political questions, but even the most deeply divisive ones. Indeed, that only in this way can the most divisive questions be peacefully managed. But this study also highlights how difficult it can be to assemble a majority capable of acting effectively on critical questions, to prevent a majority from acting unjustly toward a minority, and to persuade members of a powerful minority to accept the results of democratic decisions that do not go their way. The capability of a people to govern themselves. Abraham Lincoln closed his Gettysburg Address on November 19, 1863, by expressing the hope that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth. The address articulated Lincoln's conviction that perpetuating government by the people required both a recommitment to the Declaration of Independence's 1776 proposition that all men are created equal, and a new birth of freedom, a tacit but unmistakable reference to the emancipation of human beings held in slavery. By 1863, emancipation had become an official Union war aim as well as a critical strategy for winning the war. When Lincoln delivered this address, he had concluded that winning the war, preserving the Union, and abolishing slavery had all become essential to saving the American Revolution's promise of government of, by, and for the people. But Lincoln never wanted such a war. His hope had been that time, discussion, and the ballot box, as he phrased it in his July 4, 1861 message to Congress in special session, would be sufficient to address even the most difficult and divisive political questions, and that slavery could be abolished gradually, peacefully, and democratically. We know that this is not the direction American history took. Instead, slavery was abolished in a lethal and destructive civil war. In his second inaugural address, on March 4, 1865, Lincoln acknowledged there might have been some terrible but divine justice in this mighty scourge of war. Yet we cannot understand Lincoln's political thought, both before and during the war, without taking into account his faith that government of, by, and for the people ought to have been able to resolve the slavery crisis peacefully, as well as his commitment to restore a free, democratic political order in which, when ballots have fairly and constitutionally decided, there can be no successful appeal back to bullets. Lincoln's defense of majority rule, his understanding of its strengths and limitations, and his hope that it could effectively resolve even the slavery and secession crises are the focus of this book. Both Lincoln's hopes for the perpetuation of America's free political institutions and his fear that American democracy might self-destruct date to the earliest years of his political career. In his Springfield Lyceum Address of 1838, Lincoln denied that American democracy could be overthrown by a foreign power. The real threat, he observed, was internal. As a nation of free men, we must live through all time or die by suicide. He identified the prevalence of mob violence, a perversion of majority rule, as American democracy's most dangerous characteristic. But he insisted that violent mobs alone could not destroy America's free institutions. The greater danger was that ambitious, deeply lawless demagogues would exploit mob violence to destroy free institutions by pretending to save them. Lincoln's proposed remedy to mob rule was not elite rule, for elites too can act lawlessly, but for citizens to recognize that the capability of a people to govern themselves requires obeying the laws that they themselves have made. This was the strongest safeguard against democracy's worst impulses. The most transformative event of Lincoln's political career before his presidency was the passage in 1854 of the Kansas-Nebraska Act, which repealed the Missouri Compromise and allowed the white inhabitants of a newly settled federal territory to decide by majority vote whether slavery would be permitted in that territory. Lincoln regarded the Kansas-Nebraska Act not as a law, but as violence from the beginning. It was conceived in violence, passed in violence, is maintained in violence, and is being executed in violence. In Lincoln's view, the lawlessness of the act was not limited to the clashes it produced between pro-slavery and anti-slavery militias in the territory and the well-documented mass election fraud perpetrated by an early arriving pro-slavery minority. It was inherent in the legislation itself and in the process by which the law was enacted. Lincoln considered the Kansas-Nebraska Act a perversion of majority rule for two fundamental reasons. First, the act legitimated the practice of enslavement by majority vote, not only in southern states where slavery was long entrenched and difficult to remove, but also in newly organized northern territories where Congress had previously prohibited it. The doctrine of self-government is right, absolutely and eternally right, Lincoln acknowledged in his October 16, 1854 speech against the Kansas-Nebraska Act. But allowing a white majority to decide whether blacks shall be enslaved could be called self-government only if one assumed that persons of African descent were not human beings. But if the Negro is a man, is it not to that extent a total destruction of self-government to say that he too shall not govern himself? Lincoln's second fundamental objection to the Kansas-Nebraska Act was that it failed, even on its own terms, to establish a fair and legitimate process by which the overwhelmingly white inhabitants of a newly settled territory could vote to prohibit slavery. Instead, Lincoln charged, the Kansas-Nebraska Act enabled an early arriving pro-slavery minority to seize control of a new territory through force and fraud introduce slavery into that territory, and make it difficult or impossible for a large anti-slavery majority later to remove it. Thus, while the Kansas-Nebraska Act violated the rights of black Americans by permitting a white majority to vote for their enslavement, it also violated the rights of all Americans, whatever their race, by enabling a powerful minority to dominate the majority. Lincoln observed during his 1858 U.S. Senate contest with Stephen Douglas that although he had always been opposed to slavery before 1854, he had rested in the hope and belief that it was in course of ultimate extinction. And for that reason, politically, it had been a minor question with me. But passage of the Kansas-Nebraska Act convinced him that slavery was being placed on a new basis, a basis for making it perpetual, national, and universal. And for that reason, he now considered that question a paramount one. If slavery became perpetual, national, and universal, it would be beyond the power of the majority of Americans to contain, shrink, and ultimately extinguish the institution. Slavery became a paramount question for Lincoln in 1854 because, in addition to the injustice slavery inflicted on its immediate victims, the expansion and perpetuation of slavery threatened popular self-government for all members of the political community to which he belonged. It was in this sense that, as he indicated in the Gettysburg Address, a new birth of freedom was necessary to ensure that government of, by, and for the people shall not perish from the earth. But during the 1850s, Lincoln envisaged the extinction of slavery occurring peacefully and gradually rather than violently. Thus, in 1838, Lincoln raised the possibility that American democracy could self-destruct through mob violence, lawlessness, and demagoguery. In 1854, he perceived an impending threat to American democracy in the Kansas-Nebraska Act, whose moral and procedural emptiness enabled mob violence to disguise itself as law and allowed tyranny of the minority to pass itself off as the will of the people. The Kansas-Nebraska Act was also blatantly incompatible with the Declaration of Independence's proposition that all men are created equal, a common theme of Lincoln's speeches and writings in the 1850s. During that decade, he helped build the new Republican Party, denounced the Dred Scott decision in 1857, challenged Stephen Douglas, author of the Kansas-Nebraska Act, for a U.S. Senate seat in 1858, and became a contender for the Republican presidential nomination in 1860. When seven slave states of the Lower South seceded from the Union in response to his election as president, all Lincoln's hopes and fears for the future of popular self-government converged in the crisis. When an outvoted minority, at the urging of fire-eating demagogues, forcibly resisted the results of an election that did not go their way, coerced dissidents, seized federal property, and declared the Union dissolved, Lincoln saw it as mob violence on a mass scale. When secessionists pretended that the U.S. Constitution sanctioned their act, it epitomized lawlessness disguised as law. Secessionists sought to prevent the majority of Americans from deciding the single most important question facing the United States: the future of slavery. In doing so, they nullified a foundational principle of popular government by enabling the minority to rule the majority. Slaveholders did all this to perpetuate an institution that conspicuously rejected the principle of natural equality on which, in Lincoln's view, popular self-government necessarily depended. It was under these circumstances that Lincoln defended majority rule as the only true sovereign of a free people. Democratic principle and democratic process. When Abraham Lincoln was inaugurated on March 4, 1861, seven slave states, South Carolina, Mississippi, Florida, Alabama, Georgia, Louisiana, and Texas, had already seceded from the Union in response to his election. No one disputed that Lincoln had won a procedurally fair vote according to constitutional rules. He secured a 59% electoral vote majority, 180 out of 303, though he received only a plurality, just under 40%, of popular votes in the deeply divided four-way presidential contest. But the same was true of his predecessor, James Buchanan, who was elected in 1856 with a 59% electoral college majority, the bulk of his support coming from slave states, but only a 45% popular vote plurality in a three-way contest. Where Lincoln's votes came from played an important role in the rationale for secession, but the mere fact that he received less than half the popular votes was not what motivated secession. Nor could anyone claim that Lincoln, prior to taking office, had committed any unconstitutional or oppressive acts justifying secession. Indeed, Southern critics of secession argued that only an overt, unconstitutional act on Lincoln's part could legitimate secession. His winning a fair election was insufficient justification. But the arguments in favor of preemptive secession that prevailed in the Lower South, were that Lincoln endorsed what slaveholders considered the unconstitutional goal of prohibiting slavery in federal territories, that he had been elected entirely on the basis of Northern votes, and that if Southerners remained in the Union and treated his election as legitimate, it was only a matter of time before a hostile Northern majority squeezed the institution of slavery out of existence. "My friends, delay is dangerous," warned Georgia secessionist Thomas R. R. Cobb, "for ere long you will be imprisoned by walls of free states all around you." Under such circumstances, secessionists maintained, it was perfectly legitimate to dissolve the Union in response to unfavorable election results. In his first inaugural address on March 4, 1861, Lincoln replied to secessionists by setting forth a principled defense of majority rule as the only true sovereign of a free people. His immediate aim in defending majority rule was to argue against the legitimacy of a powerful minority forcibly partitioning the United States because it was dissatisfied with the results of a free, constitutionally conducted election. His wider purpose was to establish that a deliberate, constitutionally checked majority, though by no means infallible, was the appropriate ultimate authority not only in routine political questions but even on difficult, deeply divisive questions, such as the future of slavery, that might otherwise trigger violence. Lincoln did not claim that either he personally or his party already enjoyed clear majority support for their commitment to halt the expansion of slavery. He knew he had received only a plurality, not a majority, of the popular vote. And the 1860 election did not produce a Republican majority in both chambers of Congress until secession removed a significant proportion of the opposition. He had secured the Electoral College majority necessary to elect a president. But he did not claim a mandate in favor of his or his party's position on slavery. And in the address, he acknowledged the ongoing deep disagreement on several slavery-related questions. Yet he emphasized that as the constitutionally elected president, he had the right and the duty to exercise the constitutionally authorized powers of that office. He insisted that those who rejected his stance on slavery confine their opposition to constitutional channels, which in Lincoln's view did not include forcible partition of the country. Lincoln did not claim that he alone, as president, possessed the constitutional power to halt the expansion of slavery. His view, which he set forth in detail in his Cooper Institute address on February 27, 1860, was that Congress had the authority under the Constitution to prohibit slavery in territories that were not yet states and that it ought to do so. When Lincoln was inaugurated on March 4, 1861, he knew that building an anti-slavery electoral majority was a task for the future. He recognized that halting the spread of slavery and gradually squeezing it out of existence could not be accomplished quickly or easily, but he believed it could be done. So did the secessionists. They urged preemptive secession before Lincoln took office to prevent the new president, his party, and the majority of American voters from taking the first critical steps down a path leading to the eventual extinction of slavery that secessionists feared would become irreversible unless they immediately and forcefully blocked it. The result of slave states' submission to the inauguration and administration of Mr. Lincoln, Joseph E. Brown argued in the Georgia secession debate of December 1860, would be the total abolition of slavery and the utter ruin of the South in less than 25 years. Whether slavery could have been abolished gradually in the United States without civil war is an open question. What is clear, however, is that many secessionists believed this was possible. Preemptive secession by denying the legitimacy of Lincoln's election was designed to prevent the first step towards slavery's gradual extinction. In this book, I examine Lincoln's defense of majority rule, his understanding of its capabilities and limitations, and his hope that slavery could be peacefully and gradually extinguished through the action of a committed national majority. I argue that in defending majority rule under the circumstances of the slavery and secession crises, Lincoln was not merely reaffirming an American platitude. Instead, he was offering a fresh, wide-ranging, and in many respects, innovative account of the interplay between majorities and minorities in the context of cross-cutting issues and shifting public opinion. Lincoln was not a naive majoritarian. He acknowledged that majorities could act unjustly, even as he argued for the majority's function as the ultimate arbiter of divisive moral, political, and constitutional questions. His defense of majority rule presupposed that majorities were restrained by constitutional checks. But at the same time, he insisted that majorities legitimately decided constitutional meaning, and not only through the formal amendment process. He understood the phenomenon of cyclical majorities, whereby voter preferences for political decisions generate scissors-paper-rock outcomes. A defeats B, B defeats C, C defeats A. He regarded broad-based political parties as essential to the creation of stable, effective electoral majorities on critical issues. As a Republican Party builder during the 1850s, he sought to construct an enduring anti-slavery majority able to withstand the disruptive impact of cross-cutting issues such as immigration and alcohol prohibition. Lincoln's Illinois rival, Stephen Douglas, has sometimes been depicted as a principled advocate of majority rule and defender of local self-government, while Lincoln is portrayed as a centralizing elitist hostile to democracy. Robert W. Johansen, for example, writes that Lincoln was suspicious of human nature and distrustful of mass democracy, while Douglas had an almost transcendent faith in the popular will. I present an alternative picture of the difference between Lincoln and Douglas with respect to democracy and majority rule. In contrast to the image of Lincoln as inherently distrustful of local self-government, he was, in fact, confident that if slavery were kept out of a territory during its early settlement, and if an orderly and fair vote were conducted among a sufficiently large territorial population, the inhabitants would vote to prohibit slavery. But if slavery established itself early in the process of territorial settlement, the facts of its presence and the difficulty of its removal will carry the vote in its favor. Douglas, in contrast, played a sectional double game with the Kansas-Nebraska Act, leading Northerners to believe that slavery could be prohibited early in the settlement process, and assuring Southerners, whose support he needed to pass the bill, that slavery would be permitted from the beginning of settlement and prohibited only, if at all, when that territory entered the Union as a new state. In Lincoln's view, the Kansas-Nebraska Act's deliberate silence about when, how, and by what process slavery could be prohibited in a newly formed territory rendered majority rule practically meaningless. The people are to decide the question of slavery for themselves, but when they are to decide, or how they are to decide, or whether, when the question is once decided, it is to remain so, the law does not say. Is it to be decided by the first dozen settlers who arrive there? Or is it to await the arrival of 100? Is it to be decided by a vote of the people? Or a vote of the legislature? Or indeed by a vote of any sort? To these questions, the law gives no answer. Lincoln also observed that the law's procedural emptiness encouraged pro-slavery settlers to kill or drive out anti-slavery settlers. Lincoln, in short, was not an opponent of majority rule, either nationally or locally. He believed the ultimate fate of slavery had to be decided by a national majority because slavery deeply affected Americans of all races and backgrounds and threatened to extend its reach to every state and territory. At the same time, he recognized that local anti-slavery majorities were the indispensable building blocks for any national anti-slavery majority. And in either sphere, national or local, legitimate majority rule was impossible without paying careful attention to the decision-making process and ensuring that it was as fair and transparent as possible. With respect to slavery in the territories, any meaningful majority vote by territorial residents required that the status of slavery prior to such a vote be clarified, a question the Kansas-Nebraska Act deliberately left unanswered. The difference between Lincoln and Douglas has sometimes been characterized as one between democracy as a principle, in Lincoln, and democracy as a process, in Douglas. There is some truth in this observation. Nevertheless, I argue that in addition to his superior understanding of democratic principle, Lincoln had a better grasp of democratic process and the role of majority vote in that process than Douglas did. The theme of this book. Lincoln originally hoped that slavery could be ended peacefully, gradually, constitutionally, and democratically over the course of many decades and election cycles. In his first inaugural address, delivered a month before the assault on Fort Sumter in April 12th to 13th, 1861, irreversibly transformed the situation. Lincoln invoked constitutional majority rule as the only peaceful way of resolving the crisis. Moreover, he argued that even if secession were accomplished, none of the contested questions that motivated it would be resolved. Conflicts over the expansion of slavery into western territories claimed by both the Confederacy and the Union, over access to navigable rivers that flowed through both sections, and over other matters would produce violent confrontations between these legally separate but still geographically intertwined nations, and such conflicts would be even more difficult to resolve after secession. Separation was possible. Peaceful coexistence after separation was not. It was in the context of these two interlinked crises, the long escalating crisis over slavery and the sudden crisis over secession, that Lincoln articulated his defense of majority rule as the only just and peaceful way of resolving, or at least containing, the deep political divisions that occur in any popular government. That defense of majority rule forms the theme of this book. I do not positively affirm that the slavery and secession crises could have been resolved peacefully. Many who argue otherwise have made strong cases, At best, peaceful resolution of either crisis was less probable than a violent outcome. But the aim of this work is to critically examine Lincoln's political thought. For that purpose, what matters is whether his faith in the capacity of time, discussion, and the ballot box to resolve such crises was well or ill-founded, given the evidence available to him at the time. In that respect, I argue that Lincoln was overly optimistic, but not delusional. I maintain there were plausible grounds for believing that slavery could have been peacefully, gradually, and democratically extinguished. Whether that path would have been less just from the perspective of enslaved persons than the rapid wartime emancipation that historically occurred is a different question. I likewise argue that before Fort Sumter, it was not unreasonable for Lincoln to hope that the seceding states could be persuaded to refrain from initiating a civil war. And even if peaceful outcomes were far less probable in both cases than violent ones, in my judgment, it was reasonable for Lincoln, indeed it was his moral duty, to give both these nearly impossible tasks his best effort rather than to quickly settle for either the perpetuation of slavery or the terrible path of warfare. I believe that Lincoln's hopeful, reasoned deliberations on the capacity of majority rule to address deeply divisive questions merit close examination, not only by scholars of American political thought, but also by anyone concerned with the capacity of modern democracies to manage the most difficult political, social, and ideological conflicts. If we conclude that American slavery could have been extinguished only by mass violence, this has unsettling implications for the capacity of modern democracies in general, and American democracy in particular, to peacefully manage deep divisions and remedy entrenched injustices in our own time. Lincoln's faith in democracy puts our own to the test. Majority rule and the Constitution. When Lincoln called the majority the only true sovereign of a free people, he made it clear that the majority fulfilled that role only insofar as it was held in restraint by constitutional checks and limitations. But the text of the Constitution does not expressly call the majority sovereign, nor does it specify majority vote as the ultimate decision rule in Lincoln's broad sense. Lincoln's majority rule argument functioned instead as an extra-textual background theory about the Constitution's larger character and purposes, guiding the interpretation of important questions for which the text of the Constitution provides no explicit answer. To call Lincoln's formulation a background theory is not to dismiss or diminish it. All constitutional interpretation, including strict construction, draws on background theory of one kind or another. Southerners who argued that Congress must protect slavery in the territories and who insisted that states were fully sovereign and had a right to secede for any reason at all had their own background theories. These were shaped to a large degree by the constitutional thought of John C. Calhoun, 1782-1850, of South Carolina. One intriguing feature of the U.S. Constitution is that simple majority vote functions as the unspoken default rule. The Constitution specifically provides for supermajority decisions in some instances, including overriding a presidential veto, confirming a treaty, removing an impeached president from office, and proposing constitutional amendments. In all cases in which supermajorities are not specified, a simple majority is sufficient. This includes Senate votes. The filibuster is not a constitutional provision. The fact that simple majority vote is the decision rule except where otherwise specified invites two very different assumptions about majority rule in the Constitution. One, that the Constitution institutionalizes a strong commitment to majority rule as a fundamental principle of Republican government to be set aside or qualified only in a limited set of cases, or two, that the Constitution institutionalizes a weak commitment to majority rule as a decision rule for routine matters, implying that when important rights or interests are at stake, a dissenting minority should be able to block majority action. Lincoln's first inaugural address expressed a strong theory of majority rule. So long as it respected constitutional processes and did not overstep any clearly specified constitutional limitations, the majority was authorized to decide matters of great political and constitutional importance, even in the face of intense minority opposition. James Madison likewise invoked a strong version of majority rule in his denunciation of nullification in 1830. To prevent a majority in Congress from enacting any law to which the smallest fraction over one quarter of the U.S. was opposed, he argued, would allow the minority to rule the majority and thus overturn the first principle of free government, that the majority must ultimately rule even if the character and tempo of its rule were importantly shaped by constitutional checks, was for Madison, as for Lincoln, the first principle of free government. Any other decision rule would create a privileged minority. In contrast, John C. Calhoun, the principal theorist of nullification, argued that the Constitution nowhere empowered a simple majority of the U.S. population, or what Calhoun called the numerical majority, to enact anything at all. Because every piece of legislation had to pass both chambers of Congress, including the Senate, where states with highly unequal populations were equally represented, Calhoun estimated that in 1850, senators representing 40% of the federal population, that is, the free population plus the slave state's three-fifths augmentation, could defeat legislation favored by 60%. Furthermore, as Calhoun pointed out accurately, under certain conditions, the Constitution enabled a minority of U.S. citizens to elect a president over the opposition of the majority. Calhoun also showed that it was technically possible for a numerical minority of the U.S. population, residing in the smallest three-quarters of the states, to amend the Constitution over the opposition of the numerical majority. For similar reasons, it was possible for a very small minority of the U.S. population, that proportion living in one-quarter plus one of the smallest population states, to block a constitutional amendment favored by a very large majority. In short, Calhoun vehemently rejected the notion that the people of these states constitute a nation, that the nation has a will of its own, and that the numerical majority of the whole was the appropriate organ of its voice. And yet, by the time he died in 1850, Calhoun had concluded that the anti-majoritarian provisions of the Constitution were insufficient to assure the perpetuation of slavery, and he argued that secession was unavoidable unless slavery was granted additional constitutional protections. Lincoln was aware of the counter-majoritarian constitutional elements Calhoun emphasized, but he did not believe they negated the principle that in a Republican form of government, a deliberate, constitutionally checked majority legitimately held the final decision-making power. Leaving aside the three-fifths clause, which he characterized as manifestly unfair, Lincoln spoke as though constitutional checks and limitations actually strengthened majority rule by rendering it more deliberate and respectful of rights. Suppose one rejected Calhoun's construction of the Constitution and instead affirmed that majority rule was substantively implicit in the Constitution's provisions and structures. This still left many key questions open. A majority of whom? The antebellum Constitution did not specify who was entitled to vote in federal elections. Instead, it merely stipulated that whoever was qualified to vote for members of the most numerous branch of the state legislature was entitled to vote for members of the U.S. House of Representatives. In practice, this meant that nearly all women, as well as most free blacks, were not counted in determining federal majorities. Which branch or branches of the federal government best embodied a popular majority? Was it Congress? The presidency? What function did elections have in communicating the will of the majority? Did elections signify no more than voters' preference for one candidate over another? Or did electoral outcomes potentially communicate a platform or a mandate to office holders? These were important questions if one subscribed to the notion that the Constitution implicitly empowered the majority to govern. Yet the text of the Constitution answered none of them. These questions were the subject of lively constitutional debate when Lincoln began his political career in 1832 and throughout his years as a Whig office holder and spokesman. The status of majority rule under the Constitution acquired renewed urgency as the escalating slavery crisis displaced the political issues that had traditionally divided Whigs from Democrats and as the slaveholding minority sought in increasingly aggressive ways to protect slavery from adverse legislation supported by a large, growing, and predominantly northern majority. The ultimate extinction of slavery. In his House Divided speech, June 16, 1858, Lincoln called for putting slavery in course of ultimate extinction. Some have dismissed Lincoln's ultimate extinction goal as vague to the point of being empty because he did not explain how the first step, prohibiting slavery in territories that were not yet states, while allowing the institution to remain in states where it already existed, would lead to the disappearance of slavery everywhere on U.S. soil. I argue, however, that even though Lincoln did not specify a precise timeline, his formulation was far from empty. Nor did defenders of slavery treat it as an empty formula that would permit them to hold slaves indefinitely. On the contrary, they saw the election of a president who spoke such words as an existential threat to slavery's survival, and they considered it no less threatening for being gradual in execution. South Carolina, the first state to secede from the Union on December 20, 1860, listed among its chief justifications the election of a man to the high office of President of the United States, whose opinions and purposes are hostile to slavery, and who has declared that that government cannot endure permanently half-slave, half-free, and that the public mind must rest in the belief that slavery is in the course of ultimate extinction. Secessionists understood that despite the gradual pace, the ultimate goal was clear, and the inauguration of a president whose opinions and purposes were hostile to slavery was the first step. Though the timing was vague, Lincoln's ultimate extinction rested on a clear general strategy, envisaged clear political mechanisms, and included a clear set of political and constitutional criteria. The strategic idea, which Lincoln and many other Republicans embraced, was that slavery had to either expand or die, and that halting the geographic expansion of slavery would render the institution increasingly unprofitable as well as politically less powerful. The political mechanisms driving the process, and here Lincoln's thinking was distinctive, were outlined in his House Divided speech. That process began with a specific political action, followed by public opinion's response to that action, subsequent electoral reward or punishment, and finally a new disposition of public opinion enabling new actions in the same direction that would not have been possible earlier in the process. In principle, this recursive sequence, which I examine in Chapter 5, could work in either direction, toward the full legalization of slavery everywhere in the United States, or toward its complete extinction, and Lincoln sought to redirect it in an anti-slavery direction. Among Lincoln's political and constitutional criteria for the ultimate extinction process, discussed in Chapter 7, were that emancipation had to be gradual, that it had to be accomplished peacefully, that it could not violate any express constitutional provisions, and that slave owners had to be compensated, which Lincoln believed was required under the Fifth Amendment. Nor shall private property be taken for public use without just compensation. The most serious objection to Lincoln's ultimate extinction scenario was not its supposed emptiness, it was far from empty, but its dubious justice with respect to enslaved men and women. The national majority that Lincoln hoped to build in support of gradually ending slavery was an overwhelmingly white majority. The members of this free, white, non-slaveholding majority had their own interests and reasons for seeking to halt and reverse the growing political and economic power of slavery. Those interests and reasons did not necessarily align with the rights and interests of black Americans, free or enslaved. Lincoln was aware of the justice problems with his slavery extinction scenarios, but did not know how to resolve them. The most obvious justice problem was that any scenario involving the gradual extinction of slavery inevitably left millions of human beings enslaved for a long time, in many cases for the remainder of their lives. Moreover, if slavery fundamentally violated a human being's right to eat the bread without the leave of anybody else, which his own hand earns, as Lincoln phrased it in his 1858 debates with Douglas, then justice would require paying compensation to the slave, not the slaveholder. In contrast to Lincoln, radical abolitionists demanded that slavery be abolished immediately in the states as well as the territories, and that no compensation be paid to slaveholders. Many abolitionists, notably Frederick Douglass, insisted that emancipation be coupled with full citizenship, including voting rights for Americans of all races, including former slaves. The abolitionist stance unquestionably expressed a more perfect vision of justice than Lincoln's gradual extinction scenario. But neither the abolitionists nor Lincoln nor anyone else had the power to implement that vision of justice quickly except through a massive civil war, for every slave state would have seceded immediately had it been attempted. Before the war, most abolitionists were unwilling to commence a shooting war over slavery, John Brown being a conspicuous exception. Some took their cue from William Lloyd Garrison, a pacifist abolitionist who urged free states to secede from the Union, thereby absolving themselves of moral responsibility for slavery, serving as a beacon of liberty and eliminating the hateful constitutional obligation to return fugitive slaves. Many other abolitionists, without relinquishing their moral vision of immediate and complete emancipation, directed their political efforts into legal and constitutional channels, and by the late 1850s had allied themselves, reluctantly in some cases, with Lincoln and the Republican Party. Lincoln recognized that several of the Constitution's provisions, including the Three-Fifths Clause, reinforced the injustices of slavery. Nevertheless, he believed, too optimistically it turned out, that by adhering to the political and electoral processes prescribed by the Constitution, it would be possible to halt, shrink, and ultimately extinguish slavery without triggering a civil war. He also judged that only a gradualist anti-slavery platform could win majority support in Congress and among the overwhelmingly white national electorate. Race, colonization, and coexistence. Lincoln made it clear, both before the war and at least through 1862, that he favored the colonization of formerly enslaved persons outside the United States. He insisted, however, that any colonization project had to be genuinely voluntary on the part of the persons being colonized, a stipulation that practically guaranteed colonization would never occur on a mass scale. Thus, portrayals of Lincoln as planning the forced expulsion of millions of black Americans misrepresent both his policies and his principles. And unlike many advocates of colonization, including Thomas Jefferson and Henry Clay, Lincoln did not make colonization a precondition for commencing policies of gradual emancipation. Contrary to what many have asserted or assumed, Lincoln was willing, including before the war, to support gradual emancipation even if most formerly enslaved persons chose to remain in the United States as free laborers and property owners. He sought to reassure fearful white Americans that coexistence with free black Americans could be peaceful and beneficial to both races. Lincoln did not believe, however, that white Americans would ever accept black Americans as their full political, social, and civic equals. Believing that a genuinely multiracial democracy was impossible in the United States, he did not advocate it. Yet at the same time, he affirmed that persons of all races had an equal right to government based on consent of the governed as promised in the Declaration of Independence. One motivation behind Lincoln's puzzling endorsement of black colonization, which he compared to the children of Israel going out of Egyptian bondage in a body to form a self-governing nation, was that it enabled him to reconcile, if only in his mind, a conflict between principle and practice that he could not otherwise resolve. Lincoln's advocacy of colonization is among the most disturbing and puzzling aspects of his legacy. One can defend Lincoln's support for gradual rather than immediate emancipation on grounds of political realism. Immediate emancipation was impossible without a civil war. His support for colonization cannot be similarly defended, because the prospect of a voluntary exodus by millions of black Americans was deeply unrealistic. Lincoln's support for colonization also raises the much-debated question of his racial views and his motivation for declining to endorse full citizenship and voting rights for black Americans. In the last public speech of his life, on April 11, 1865, Lincoln acknowledged that the colored man desires the elective franchise. He recommended conferring it immediately upon the very intelligent and on those who serve our cause as soldiers, and suggested that for others, the franchise would come in time, but not immediately. His support for black voting rights may have partly motivated his assassin. But this was after the war had radically transformed circumstances and reshaped Lincoln's own views. In seeking to understand Lincoln's thinking before the war, we cannot sidestep the question why he declined to endorse black citizenship and voting rights and supported colonization. The antebellum Constitution prevented the federal government from directly abolishing slavery in the states. But nothing in the U.S. Constitution forbade Illinois or any other free state from extending state citizenship and voting rights to free black residents. In contrast to many of his contemporaries, including some Republicans, Lincoln never voiced doctrines of inherent black racial inferiority, nor is there persuasive evidence that he tacitly assented to such doctrines. His unwillingness to support voting rights for persons of all races was premised not on any supposed incapacity for self-government on the part of black Americans, but rather, as Lincoln himself stated, on overwhelming white opposition to political equality with blacks. During the 1858 Senate campaign, Stephen Douglas, who denied that the natural rights promised in the Declaration of Independence applied to blacks or any other inferior race, repeatedly accused Lincoln of supporting full political and social equality for blacks. Lincoln's response was to positively affirm the natural rights of human beings of all races, to deny that he planned to extend citizenship and voting rights to blacks, and to neither affirm nor deny the premise that blacks and whites were naturally equal in moral and intellectual endowment. Though Lincoln did not embrace doctrines of black racial inferiority, his hedging, defensive response to the claim that he supported racial equality may have reinforced the racial prejudices of his listeners. Lincoln was certainly correct that most white Americans opposed civil and political equality for blacks, but he also argued that political leaders inevitably shape public opinion for good or ill. He clearly believed that with deliberate effort, public opinion on slavery could be moved in an anti-slavery direction. Thus, we should ask why Lincoln believed white public opinion in opposition to civil and political equality with blacks was nearly immovable. Lincoln recognized that for black Americans to live and work in the United States without possessing equal civil and political rights, to exist as political underlings, as he phrased it, was a significant injustice. In his 1854 speech on the Kansas-Nebraska Act, in response to Douglas's claim that the act embodied the sacred right of self-government because it authorized the white majority to vote slavery up or down, Lincoln replied, "When the white man governs himself, that is self-government. But when he governs himself and also governs another man, that is more than self-government. That is despotism. Allow all the governed an equal voice in the government, and that only, is self-government. The principle Lincoln voiced here clearly condemned slavery as the most extreme form of ruling others without their consent. But it is equally clear that Lincoln's statement reaches far beyond slavery. It also condemns every form of government that does not accord an equal right of consent to all those subject to its authority. The conclusion appears inescapable that free blacks living within the boundaries of the United States and subject to its laws were entitled, according to the principles set forth in the Declaration of Independence, to an equal voice in the government. Yet in the next paragraph, Lincoln put the brakes on the radical implications of the principle he had just affirmed. Necessity, he quickly added, prevented the establishment of political and social equality between the whites and blacks. Necessity functions here as it did for Lincoln's advocacy of gradual rather than immediate abolition, to explain why the prescriptions of justice could not be readily implemented in practice. But in contrast to slavery, where the Constitution, enormous vested economic interests, and the very real prospect of civil war factored into the necessities preventing immediate emancipation, no comparable factors prevented non-slave states like Illinois from extending equal civil and political rights to free persons of color. The obstacles, as Lincoln saw them, lay almost entirely in a certain disposition of public opinion among the white majority. In the same speech, implicitly referring to the abolitionist position that persons of African descent held in bondage should be not only emancipated, but also made politically and socially our equals, Lincoln observed, "My own feelings will not admit of this, and if mine would, we well know that those of the great mass of white people will not. Whether this feeling accords with justice and sound judgment is not the sole question, if indeed it is any part of it. A universal feeling, whether well or ill-founded, cannot be safely disregarded. We cannot then make them equals. It does seem to me that systems of gradual emancipation might be adopted, but for their tardiness in this, I will not undertake to judge our brethren of the South." Lincoln thus claimed that among the great mass of white people, there existed a universal feeling in opposition to political and social equality between blacks and whites. He admitted to sharing this feeling himself while questioning whether it accords with justice and sound judgment. Indeed, he acknowledged that it may be ill-founded. Nowhere in this passage or elsewhere in his writings did Lincoln argue that persons of African descent were incapable of participating responsibly in the practice of democratic self-government. Yet whereas Lincoln could envisage and recommend a gradual abolition of slavery, he spoke here and elsewhere as though white opposition to racial equality was an unalterable social and psychological fact. Thus, taking Lincoln at his word, both the rule of a master over a slave and the rule by one group of persons possessing political rights over another group that, though legally free, lacked equal civil and political rights, were injustices. Slavery was the greater injustice of the two, but in certain respects, it was more susceptible to remedy. So long as black Americans, who were formerly free, as in not enslaved, remained in the United States as a demographic minority amid a white majority that would not accept them as social and political equals, they suffered an injustice without a politically available remedy. This helps explain, though it does not justify, Lincoln's endorsement of colonization. If black Americans freely chose to go out of bondage in a body like the biblical children of Israel and form a flourishing, self-governing republic, they would cease to suffer both the great injustice of slavery and the lesser but still significant injustice of political disenfranchisement, and white Americans would no longer bear the moral stain of inflicting either type of injustice on the black race. Yet the notion that millions of free black Americans would agree to be transported under the sponsorship of the U.S. government to some other part of the world to form their own self-governing political orders was deeply impractical from the outset, as Lincoln himself seemed to realize even as he promoted the idea. Lincoln's reference to Africa as the native land of blacks, many of whom by the 1850s had deeper family roots in North America than most white Americans, revealed an ignorance of black communities and their aspirations. Most black abolitionists agreed with Frederick Douglass that the United States was black Americans' homeland, and they demanded that the nation treat them justly. Dissenting black abolitionists like Martin Delaney and Henry Highland Garnett, who urged mass emigration from the United States in the 1850s, did not regard Africa as black Americans' native land. Instead, they had concluded that white Americans would never treat black Americans justly and were willing to immigrate to any part of the world where a new self-governing black community might be formed. The form in which Lincoln advocated colonization was not marked by the deep injustice that characterized many such proposals. Lincoln recognized the injustice suffered by black Americans, enslaved or free, in being governed without their consent. Forced removal would have violated the principle of consent more radically than continued residence without the franchise. Nor did Lincoln propose that the situation of free black Americans deliberately be made harsher, as some state laws aimed to do during the 1850s, so that blacks would be motivated to voluntarily emigrate. Nevertheless, even if colonization were voluntary and the number of participants small, and even if his support was motivated in part by principled opposition to politically unequal status for any group of human beings, Lincoln's colonization scheme would have underscored in another way black Americans' unequal political voice, for such a policy communicated the message, "You are free to stay, but we hope you will choose to leave." That would be sufficient to mark every black American as politically marginal. Moreover, public funds for colonization likely would have come at the expense of public spending on initiatives, including education, to support black Americans who chose to remain in the land of their birth. Though Lincoln declined to endorse voting rights for black Americans and promoted an ill-conceived colonization idea, in one important respect in the late 1850s, he sought to prepare white Americans for coexistence with a growing number of free blacks. This occurred in the economic sphere. One of the principal fears Lincoln sought to address as a spokesperson for the Republican Party was the frequently advanced claim that the emancipation of blacks would unleash a zero-sum economic struggle, or even a life-or-death struggle for survival between the races. White working-class men from free states were especially susceptible to such claims. If the zero-sum premise were accepted, it followed that the economic survival of the white race depended on either keeping the black race permanently enslaved, so blacks could not compete with whites in the free labor market, or forcibly removing blacks from the United States. Lincoln was unwilling to support either course of action. Instead, he challenged the premise that the two races were locked in such a struggle in the first place. He did so in several public speeches in 1859 and 1860, and again during the war in preparing white Americans for the Emancipation Proclamation. He rejected the idea that relations between the races resembled two wrecked seamen on a narrow plank, when each must push the other off or drown himself. In fact, Lincoln insisted, "The plank is large enough for both. This good earth is plenty broad enough for white man and Negro both, and there is no need of either pushing the other off." At the time, Lincoln still supported colonization. But by emphasizing that the plank is large enough for both races to coexist without one enslaving the other, he signaled that emancipation without colonization was acceptable and workable. This was not the same as advocating for racial equality across the board. Under the circumstances, however, it was a crucial point for Lincoln to communicate to the white, principally northern non-slaveholding majority whose votes were critical to the goal of halting the spread of slavery and gradually squeezing it out of existence. If the United States had practiced universal suffrage in the 1850s, Lincoln would not have had to focus almost entirely on persuading the white majority to respect the rights, interests, and humanity of blacks. Black Americans with voting rights would have been their own most effective advocates. Democracy, as a theory of government, does not require that most people be willing to put the interests of others, and especially the most vulnerable, ahead of their own interests. Some people are willing to do this, most are not. Democracy presupposes instead that most individuals are able and willing to stand up for their own interests through their voices and votes, and that they are able and willing, when necessary, to reach an accommodation with others whose views and interests differ from their own. But the American democracy in which Lincoln lived and acted was radically flawed with respect to race and slavery. Among those flaws was that those who suffered the greatest injustices did not possess the power of the vote. For that reason, they found it difficult to motivate their countrymen to remedy those injustices or to reward candidates for office who took their side and punished those who did not. If significantly greater numbers of black Americans had possessed voting rights, Lincoln, who was, among other things, a politician seeking votes, likely would have spoken differently about race, voting rights, and the pace of emancipation. His freedom of action would not have been so narrowly circumscribed by what the great mass of white people thought. But under the actual circumstances of antebellum America, anyone who hoped to remedy the nation's racial injustices was confronted by a horrific dilemma. Apart from violent resistance by enslaved persons on a mass scale, which was difficult, perilous, and uncertain of success, the only way to extend civil and political rights to black Americans was to persuade the white majority to support that extension. In this respect, those abolitionists publicly committed to equal civil and political rights for persons of all races confronted exactly the same dilemma as Lincoln did. They too had to persuade a white majority. Abolitionists chose to speak the truth without compromise and leave the outcome to God. Lincoln focused on those battles that he believed could be won. Why another book on Lincoln? What can you say about Abraham Lincoln that hasn't already been said? The author of a new book about Lincoln is inevitably asked this question. The question presupposes that a finite number of statements can be made about any subject, and that as the stack of books and articles on a subject grows higher, the number of possible new statements shrinks to zero. The truth is that when a theme is important, ballots versus bullets as channels for political disagreement, for example, there is always something new to say because our own anxious and ever-changing experience drives us to seek clarity and perspective wherever we can discover it. What makes Lincoln significant is the inexhaustible complexity and importance of the crisis through which he lived and acted. That is why so much has been written about him and his times, and why there is always room for more. But there is a more specific justification for the present work. Despite a mountain of books and articles about Abraham Lincoln, there has been surprisingly little extended commentary on his understanding of majority rule. Much has been written about Lincoln's political leadership, political rhetoric, constitutional thought, observations on public opinion, and many other themes relevant to the practice of majority rule. The key passage on majority rule from his first inaugural address is frequently mentioned and sometimes quoted at length, but is rarely examined in detail. Some commentaries on Lincoln treat his defense of majority rule as obvious and straightforward, indeed as a mere platitude of the age. Others rightly emphasize the limits Lincoln placed on majority rule and his desire to prevent majority tyranny, while paying less attention to how Lincoln also sought to empower majority rule on the national level to address the slavery crisis. Still, other writers use his defense of majority rule to remind readers that Lincoln did not receive a majority of popular votes in the 1860 election. Most of all, I suspect Lincoln's defense of majority rule in the first inaugural address is neglected because subsequent events seemingly rendered it irrelevant. It was not by peaceful deliberation and majority vote, but by military force in a horrifyingly destructive war that slavery was abolished in the United States. For this reason, serious engagement with Lincoln's defense of majority rule as the only peaceful method of addressing deep political disagreement requires a certain degree of counterfactual speculation. In that sense, my approach is unusual, and I hope listeners will judge it to be fruitful. There is a large literature, both scholarly and popular, on Lincoln and democracy. But democracy and majority rule are not the same thing. Democracy is a multivalent moral and political ideal, typically encompassing the equal worth of all human beings, the promise of a fair chance in the race of life, trust in the capacity of ordinary men and women to deliberate and choose responsibly, and more. Philip Shaw Paladin calls attention to Lincoln's own concise definition of democracy. "As I would not be a slave, so I would not be a master. This expresses my idea of democracy. Whatever differs from this, to the extent of the difference, is no democracy. The idea that it is best for a human being to live free, neither enslaved by nor enslaving another, exemplifies democracy as a personal, political, and moral ideal. Majority rule, in contrast, is democracy's characteristic decision mechanism, but is not an element we typically idealize. Lincoln defended majority rule as the decision method that, compared to the alternatives, minority rule, anarchy, violence, best facilitates and least threatens this neither slave nor master ideal. It is not my intention to sing hymns of praise to 50% plus one or to suggest that Lincoln did so, but I do give majority rule more sustained attention than most other writers on Lincoln have done. I also pay closer attention to Lincoln's understanding of political parties than do most studies of his political thought. Some historians of American political development have made perceptive observations about Lincoln's efforts and achievements as a party builder. But most studies of Lincoln's political thought neglect his understanding of the function of political parties in a healthy democracy and the specific role he envisioned for the Republican Party in convincing the public mind to rest in the belief that slavery is in course of ultimate extinction. Harry Jaffa, for example, contrasts Lincoln's profound meditations on natural right and the survival of popular government with the many years he spent as a skilled practitioner of the arts of party politics, and thus, to put it bluntly, a hack politician, suggesting that Lincoln's party building, at least during his Whig years, was politically necessary but philosophically uninteresting. Lincoln himself did not view it this way. Here I attempt to do justice to the significant time and energy Lincoln spent theorizing about parties as well as organizing them. The debate over Lincoln's positions on race, voting rights, and colonization has continued for a long time because the matters at stake have lost none of their contemporary urgency, and because Lincoln's often evasive statements have been interpreted in sharply different ways. I do not pretend to settle those debates, but I hope my emphasis on Lincoln's effort to build an enduring anti-slavery majority among an overwhelmingly white electorate helps distinguish between what Lincoln could have said or done differently without crippling that majority-building project, and what would have been impossible for anyone to do under the circumstances without inviting a civil war. My treatment of Lincoln's attempt to refute the widely shared assumption that whites and blacks were locked into a zero-sum economic struggle also breaks fresh ground in the Lincoln literature. This theme, too, has enduring contemporary relevance, for in our post-civil rights America, a high percentage of white Americans continue to view black Americans' social and economic advances as coming at their expense. Finally, my examination of Lincoln's account of majority rule offers a fresh perspective on his understanding of natural right and its relationship to the practices and processes of electoral democracy. The relationship between natural right and majority rule in Lincoln's thought is a theme that runs throughout this book. In Chapter 8, I developed this topic through an extended discussion of Lincoln and John Locke, whose ideas shaped the preamble to the Declaration of Independence, the framing of the Constitution, and much of what was said and done in the early Republic. Lincoln probably did not read Locke's second treatise of civil government, but he had secondhand access to Lockean ideas through multiple channels. In important ways, Lincoln's reconstruction of natural right went beyond Locke. The principles set forth in Locke's second treatise cannot justify the original act of enslaving a free person in the state of nature, but the application of Locke's principles to an established society where past acts of enslavement have long been codified into property rights is less clear. American slave owners argued that no matter how the institution of slavery originally came into existence, to deprive them now of their legal right to hold slaves violated their Lockean natural rights and justified violent resistance to the government. Lincoln challenged this argument by prioritizing the Lockean natural right to the fruits of one's labor, which the institution of slavery conspicuously violated, over the right to property in other forms. Nor did Locke's discussion of natural right offer any solution to Thomas Jefferson's dilemma, whereby the enslaved person's natural right to liberty conflicts with the slave owner's natural right to self-preservation. I argue in Chapter 8 that Lincoln relied on majority rule, in a strong form consistent with Locke's own defense of majority rule, to modify circumstances through political action and thus eliminate, or at least minimize, a clash of natural rights that cannot be resolved at the level of abstract principle. My perspective on Lincoln majority rule and natural right differs in important respects from that of Jaffa in Crisis of the House Divided. Jaffa rightly emphasized that, for Lincoln, democracy is a form of government dependent on a prior commitment to the principles of natural right, including the natural equality of persons as expressed in the Declaration of Independence. Lincoln understood this. Stephen Douglas, despite his commitment to the democratic process in other respects, did not. For Jaffa, and for Lincoln as Jaffa read him, the majority had a right to rule only insofar as its actions accorded with natural right. Moreover, in Jaffa's view, the American commitment to Lockean principles unquestionably committed Americans to the position that slavery was a violation of natural right. Indeed, Jaffa treats the incompatibility of slavery with Lockean natural right as so obvious as to require only a brief statement, and he dismisses out of hand the pro-slavery version of the Lockean natural right to property, which Lincoln himself had to confront and answer. Lincoln believed that the principles of natural right should limit and guide the practice of majority rule. But for Lincoln, the arrow of primacy could simultaneously point in the other direction. Majority rule was necessary to limit and guide interpretations of natural right. In a political community committed to the principles of natural right, as Lincoln urged the United States to be, there can still be deep disagreement over what those principles entail in practice. Lincoln's first inaugural address presented a deliberate majority as the ultimate arbiter of all deeply divisive questions, including moral and constitutional disagreements. He did so not because he believed majorities necessarily know best, but because he recognized that powerful minorities, for example, a state claiming sovereignty or a Supreme Court, do not necessarily exemplify justice and wisdom either, and their errors and injustices cannot be corrected in subsequent elections as readily as those of the majority. Moreover, legitimate natural right claims may come into potentially violent conflict with one another. A slave owner might plausibly claim, as Thomas Jefferson did, that under prevailing circumstances the slave's natural right to freedom clashed with the slave owner's natural right to self-preservation. We have the wolf by the ear, Jefferson famously said of slavery, and we can neither hold him nor safely let him go. Justice is in one scale and self-preservation in the other. This dilemma cannot be resolved at the level of abstract right, but it might be remedied in practice by persuading the slave owner that his fears are misplaced and, or by altering the circumstances such that slave owners can no longer plausibly claim that protecting their own life and liberty requires keeping other human beings in bondage. In Lincoln's view, the majority, through its elected representatives, could enact policies that altered political and social circumstances such that slavery could be safely as well as justly abolished. In short, for Lincoln, majority rule was not merely the handmaiden of natural right, but, in another sense, an equal partner with a different but complementary mission. Overview of the book. This is a critical examination of Abraham Lincoln's political thought, in historical context, with specific attention to his understanding of majority rule. Lincoln did not write treatises comparable to Locke's Second Treatise of Civil Government, but he made fresh, concise, remarkably precise statements on fundamental political themes, including his defense of majority rule compared to the alternatives and his argument that natural rights should be understood progressively rather than statically. These statements are worthy of an enduring work of political philosophy, but in Lincoln's case, the rest of his treatise, so to speak, was embedded in his actions and in the wider political crisis to which he was responding. The narrative principally focuses on Lincoln's words and actions between 1854, when passage of the Kansas-Nebraska Act deeply alarmed him and caused him to fear for the future of the American experiment in self-government, and March 1861, when he was inaugurated president. But I also examine Lincoln's political thinking before 1854, because his sense of both the promise and the fragility of America's free institutions dates to the earliest years of his career and helps explain his response to the Kansas-Nebraska Act. The onset of the Civil War did not erase Lincoln's commitment to peaceful majority rule, nor halt his reflections on the survival of popular self-government. He knew his party could lose its congressional majority in the 1862 elections and that he himself might be voted out of office in 1864. He never suggested that those elections be canceled or postponed because of the war. But the challenges of sustaining a wartime majority within the northern section of a severed Union differed fundamentally from the task of building a peacetime majority within an intact union that included every slaveholder, as well as every enslaved person in the United States. For that reason, I draw on Lincoln's words and actions during the war only when they shed light on what he hoped to accomplish before the war, and how he hoped to do so. For example, I discuss Lincoln's wartime observations in his July 4, 1861 message to Congress in special session on time, discussion, and the ballot box, as the legitimate channel for resolving political disagreements because they continue and expand on his defense of peacetime majority rule in the first inaugural address. Chapter 2 is an extended commentary on Lincoln's defense of majority rule in his first inaugural address. It examines, among other things, what Lincoln meant by calling the majority sovereign. The dual character of majority rule was both restrained by and the ultimate judge of the Constitution. How Lincoln's understanding of majority rule compares with James Madison's analysis of factions and John C. Calhoun's diagnosis of majority tyranny. Lincoln's observations on the problem of cyclical majorities, his stipulation that majorities be both deliberate and easily changeable, his response to the argument that a sectional majority was inherently illegitimate and oppressive, and his ultimately unsuccessful appeal to time, discussion, and the ballot box for peaceful resolution of the secession crisis. Chapter 3 explores Lincoln's political thought during the Whig phase of his political career from 1834 to 54, when he denounced mob violence, helped build a Whig party with a broad popular base, supported a positive role for government in promoting economic development, criticized untethered presidential power, opposed the Mexican War, and took several public stances against slavery without making that issue his priority. I suggest that Lincoln did not place opposition to slavery at the center of his political efforts during this period because he did not yet perceive slavery as a fundamental threat to Republican self-government for the overwhelmingly white political community to which he belonged. From 1854 onward, he did perceive slavery as a fundamental threat of this kind, and for that reason merged his anti-slavery politics with his long-standing hopes and fears about the survival of popular self-government. Chapter 4 describes the evolution of Lincoln's understanding of majority rule from 1854, when he denounced the Kansas-Nebraska Act as a perversion of majority rule, through 1858, when he delivered his House Divided speech. In 1854, Lincoln still hoped Southern leaders would agree to restore the Missouri Compromise in a spirit of mutual concession, that is, as a pact between free states and slave states. By the time he delivered the House Divided speech in 1858, Lincoln recognized that no North-South pact could resolve the slavery crisis. That would be the task of a national, principally free state majority, and the Republican Party as the vehicle of that majority. Chapter 5 describes how Lincoln sought to overcome the obstacles to organizing a national anti-slavery electoral majority. He believed the majority of America was anti-slavery in sentiment, but transforming anti-slavery sentiment into effective anti-slavery action required cooperation among many mutually hostile constituencies, including former Whigs, former Democrats, politically oriented abolitionists, immigrants, nativists, temperance activists, and others who had little in common beyond their opposition to the continued expansion of slavery. The chapter also examines the political dynamics underlying Lincoln's House Divided thesis, whereby an act affecting slavery in either a pro-slavery or anti-slavery direction is tested in a subsequent election, the results of which reshape public opinion and enable new actions in that same direction. Chapter 6 examines Lincoln's troubling stances on political equality across racial lines and colonization. I argue that even as he endorsed colonization, Lincoln sought to reconcile white Americans to the reality that most formerly enslaved men and women would choose to remain in the United States. Chapter 7 describes Lincoln's belief that slavery could be extinguished peacefully, gradually, democratically, and constitutionally through a long, slow territorial squeeze. I locate Lincoln's reasoning within the broader context of how other Republicans thought and spoke about this question. I also suggest that Lincoln's fear that slavery, if not urgently resisted, would ultimately be nationalized throughout the United States was realistic, not overblown or paranoid. Chapter 8 describes how Lincoln both revitalized and transformed the Lockean natural right tradition. I examine slaveholders' politically influential claim that they had not only a constitutional right, but also a natural right to hold human beings as property. I argue that, on the basis of abstract principle alone, Lockean theory was insufficient to resolve the clashing natural right claims that a long-entrenched system of slavery generated. I believe that the degree of authority Locke entrusted to the majority, which parallels Lincoln's case for majority rule in important respects, provides a better foundation than natural right alone for the peaceful, democratic extinction of slavery envisioned by Lincoln. The chapter closes by examining secessionists' unconvincing claim that both the U.S. Constitution and the Lockean right of revolution provided adequate justification for their act. I also describe secessionists' efforts to explain why slaveholders possessed a natural right of resistance, while the persons they held in bondage did not. The conclusion returns to the question whether democracies are capable of addressing especially difficult and divisive issues such as the future of slavery in the United States. The actual course of events from 1861 to 1865, preemptive secession followed by a civil war and emancipation by military force, might appear to demonstrate that democracy as a form of government is incapable of peacefully resolving fundamental disagreements. I suggest that the historical record leaves this question hanging. It was not that a democratic solution to slavery was attempted and failed, but rather that the attempt itself was forestalled because its opponents believed it might succeed. I then turn to our own troubled time, when American democracy is afflicted by bitter, increasingly dangerous divisions. I raise the question whether Americans' declining faith in their own democracy and their increased unwillingness to accept electoral results that do not go their way indicates that government of the people, by the people, for the people, is once again at risk of dying by suicide, as Lincoln feared in 1838, 1854, and 1861. 2. We divide into majorities and minorities. Lincoln's most precise statement on majority rule came in his first inaugural address on March 4, 1861, where he described a deliberate, constitutionally checked majority as the only true sovereign of a free people. His immediate purpose was to defend the legitimacy of majority rule in the face of a powerful minority's effort to partition the United States because it was dissatisfied with the results of a free and fair election. His broader aim was to argue that the majority, though by no means infallible, was the appropriate ultimate authority not only on routine political questions but also on difficult, deeply divisive questions, such as the future of slavery, that could otherwise trigger violent contests. In this chapter, I examine Lincoln's defense of majority rule as set forth in his first inaugural address and explore several themes and critical questions in historical context. Lincoln did not claim that he or his party already enjoyed clear majority support for their position on slavery. Lincoln had received only a plurality, just under 40% of the popular vote in 1860's four-way presidential contest, and the Republican Party lacked a majority in Congress until secession depleted the ranks of the opposition. Lincoln defended majority rule as a constitutionally regulated process, not as a presidential or party mandate. He knew that building a clear majority in Congress and in the American electorate in favor of halting and reversing the spread of slavery was a task for the future, but he believed it was possible. The secessionists likewise believed it was possible, indeed probable, and took forceful, evasive action to foreclose the attempt. Constitutional context of the argument. Lincoln's defense of majority rule in the first inaugural address immediately followed his discussion of a series of disputed constitutional questions. We typically think of a written constitution as limiting the scope of majority decision, and the U.S. Constitution served this function for Lincoln. But he opened this section of the address by reversing the roles. He argued that when the meaning of the Constitution itself is deeply disputed, as it was during the political crisis that triggered secession, the only peaceful and legitimate way to resolve these disputes is through the decision of a deliberate majority formed in accordance with clearly specified constitutional processes. All profess to be content in the Union if all constitutional rights can be maintained, Lincoln observed. But it was precisely the nature and extent of those constitutional rights, particularly on matters related to slavery, that were in dispute. Such constitutional disputes cannot be resolved simply by invoking the Constitution itself, as though its meaning is always clear. Instead, Lincoln distinguished between two categories of constitutional provisions: plainly written provisions, whose meaning he presumed was not in dispute, and other critical questions that the text of the Constitution does not expressly answer. He then asked whether any right, plainly written in the Constitution, has been denied. He granted that if, by the mere force of numbers, a majority should deprive a minority of any clearly written constitutional right, it might, in a moral point of view.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.